Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to you. We're excited to come into your living room, especially on Mother's Day, and wish you a happy Mother's Day, and believe Jesus is going to help you to be the happiest mother you could ever be. And if you're a happy mother, you're going to be happy children, there's going to be happy husbands, happy fathers. And so we want to welcome you out this morning, and we pray the Lord Jesus will really bless your life. We're going to sing a few songs. We want to invite you to join with us in those songs, and right there where you are in your home, you would just stand, sing, clap your hands, and enjoy what Jesus Christ has for our lives. We're going to start singing that song, He's the King of Kings. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it on the streets. He is the Lord. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it on the streets. He is the Lord. Every knee shall bow. Every knee shall bow. Every knee. Every tongue confess, every tongue confess, every tongue. Every demon tremble, every demon tremble, every demon. Every voice shall rise and say, Jesus is Lord, Jesus is Lord. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it on the streets. He is Lord. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to shout it on the streets. He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every knee shall bow, every knee. Every tongue confess, every tongue confess, every tongue. Every demon tremble, every demon tremble, every demon. Every voice shall rise and say, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Yes, he is Lord this morning, and we're going to sing another song, I Will Enter His Gates with Thanksgiving in My Heart. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Maybe if you just stand right there where you are and lift your hands to Jesus Christ. We lift our hands to God, it's the universal sign of surrender. I learned that a long time ago. You know, when the police stick a gun on your back, you raise your hands. You raise your hands, you surrender. Jesus doesn't stick a gun on our back, but I tell you what, he's got our back. And we lift our hands in praise and honor and give him glory. So if you'd stand with me where you are, we want to just do that. We want to sing that song, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. 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 No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. I won't turn back, no turning back. The cross before me and the world's behind me. The cross before me and the world's behind me. The cross before me and the world's behind me. I won't turn back. No turning back. You can take the whole world, just give me Jesus. You can take the whole world, just give me Jesus. You can take the whole world, just give me Jesus. I won't turn back, no turning back. Would you tell them that right there in your own mind right now? Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you, O God. Caranda nereño rebo si bebe bebo de bebondonie. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. We do want to welcome you out to the Door Christian Fellowship this morning. We're very privileged that you would take the time on this Mother's Day to open your heart and to be with us to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to pray for a number of things this morning. We want to pray for our president and all that God's doing in his life and all of the counsel that he has there, all the people that are around him that are trying to give him the best information about this coronavirus difficulty we've been dealing with for seems like forever. But it's almost over, folks. It's almost over. I'm telling you, I feel it. And so we want to pray for our president, all his advisors. We want to pray for all the nations of the earth that are all facing it in various degrees, and all those leaders that in time of crisis they would come to Jesus Christ. That's the only place you need to go in a time of crisis is to Jesus. We want to pray for the first responders. I was praying this morning, and when I was praying this morning, I was just thinking about the police. It's got to be a hard job to be a policeman right now, because you're going to be asking people to stop doing things that they have been doing a whole life. And I know it doesn't sit very well with me, and I'm probably not the best citizen in the world. But I really had a burden for all the police. They have families, they have wives, they have children, they have mothers, they have grandmothers. And it's got to be a really difficult job for them, especially in this time. So we really want to pray for all of our police, that God really helps them, our other first responders, our frontline responders, those that are doctors and nurses and healthcare professionals in the nursing homes all over the world, that God would really help them as they deal in their different places. Especially Giselle was telling me about some of her doctors in New Jersey and New York. They've been down sick with this coronavirus, and they've contracted that God would bring healing to their life. If you know anybody that's contracted that you would believe God and you'd pray for them with us right now. We want to pray for Brian Zapanta's aunt Yolanda and Sonny, her husband, his uncle. They've been to hospital. They're recovering from that. We want to pray for Tatiana and her husband for healing for her son. We want to pray for Adris. Want to pray for Chantella and her mama, that God would really move on their lives and really help them as well. We want to pray for the Tucson Church, the Door website, all the different prayer requests that are up on that website. Go to it every day and pray for those people. And in praying for others, you realize how quickly your problems are dismissed. They have a 40-day fast on that's been on for some period of time, and they've been working through that. And so I encourage you to be involved in that. We want to pray that through these live stream services, hearts would be touched, lives would be changed, bodies would be healed, and a fresh commitment to Jesus Christ. So we want to also pray for all the mothers that are there, the mothers and the grandmothers, some are single mothers, some are mothers that maybe have lost a child. I know one that has lost a child. She's in South Africa. I especially want to pray for Catherine. She's the daughter of a pastoral friend of mine, and I really want to pray for her. Just before Easter, she lost her child, was healthy all the way through, and that child was taken from her, and the Lord Jesus took that child home to heaven. I want to pray for her. We want to pray for other mothers that at some time in their life, they had an abortion. That's a heavy thing. And so I want to pray for you mothers that have had that, and single mothers especially. I want you to just open your heart to Jesus and let Jesus touch your life. I want to pray for my wife. She's the mother of all mothers as far as I'm concerned. She's been so good to all of our children, and they've learned so well from that. She's up in Sacramento. She's there with my daughter Jessica, who's becoming a fine mother in her own right. It's also her birthday, so I would like to wish her a happy birthday on Mother's Day. And I want to just believe God to continue to help all the mothers. And through this sermon, I pray that you'll just get a glimpse of how Jesus Christ sees you. When you recognize how Jesus sees you, it doesn't matter how anybody else sees you, because you're incredibly valuable to him. You provide something that is just nothing else can be done. No one else can do it, what you can do. And so I really do hope that you'll get that out of this sermon. I've watched several other sermons. I watched two sermons in Australia. Australia has already had their Mother's Day. So I have friends that are pastors over there. I watched Pastor Peter Field and his Mother's Day sermon. I watched Pastor Greg Farrell and his Mother's Day sermon. I'll watch another couple before the day is finished, because I want to make sure that I'm giving the best that I can give, because I watch these men giving the best that they can give. I'm going to preach again tonight on mothers, and I was going to finish after that, but I heard something in one of the sermons that Greg Farrell preached that sparked my interest on another sermon that I need to get ready and prepare. But I tell you that we're going to pray right now, and we're going to ask God to help all the mothers, the grandmothers that are there. Some mothers are really feeling lonely right now. They're hurting, and they're not with their children. There might be all kinds of things that we have no idea of. And so we want to pray for that right now. Father, right now, in the name of your Son, Jesus, we're asking you, God, to do what only you can do in the inner man, in the inner woman. Father, we thank you for our mothers. God, we thank you for the grandmothers of the world. God, we thank you for the single mothers that are struggling in life. Father, we thank you for the mothers that feel lonely and oppressed today. Oh, God, we ask you, Lord, to visit every one of us. Lord, to help us to value our mothers, to value our grandmothers, for the mothers to value themselves as you value them, Lord. Help them to see themselves as you see them, especially in this time of lockdown, God. They're doing so much in so many ways with their children. Oh, God, I pray your blessing and your favor be upon them. I'm asking that in the strong name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We do welcome you out to the services this morning, and as I said, we count it a great privilege to be able to come into your home and bring the Word of God to you, because the Word of God is very, very powerful. And I want to talk to you about the impossible woman this morning. And I had a couple of slides up there, and that's the slide that I had. It says, a mother's love is the fuel that enables a normal human being to do the impossible. A mother's love is the fuel that enables another human being to do the impossible. And it's pretty impossible to be a woman today. It's really, really hard to be the woman that God created you to be when we're not following him. And even when we are following him, it's extremely hard. And so I want to welcome you out to our services and believe God's going to help you. Tonight I'm going to preach about the woman that had three strikes. You know, in California, it's three strikes and you never get out. Three strikes and you're out in baseball, three strikes and you never get out. This woman had six strikes against her, actually, and yet Jesus not only got her out, did a wonderful miracle in her life, and I want to speak about her this evening. But I want to take the offering this morning, and I do again encourage all of you that have been continuing to give of your tithe and to give of your offering, because you know, a mother, that's what she's born to give. That's her life. Her life is all about giving. And that's really what a mother church is all about. That's what church is all about. It's all about a people that will continue to give. It doesn't make any difference how they feel, even what they have. They will give of what they have so that others can have something. That's what a mother does. That's what a mother church does as well. And I want to read a portion of scripture to you out of the book of Deuteronomy. and chapter 24. And I want to start right there. Because the other thing this morning when I was praying, I was thinking, you know, I'm the product of a single mom. And then I started thinking, you know what? I'm not. I've been largely the product of a fatherless and a motherless home. That started when I was about 10 years old. And my father had not yet abandoned my mother physically, but he had emotionally in every other way. And my mother was not handling that well. By the time I was 12, my father had abandoned our home, and my mother couldn't handle that abandonment, and she wound up going into a mental institution, and pretty much most of my life was fatherless and motherless. And then I gave my life to Jesus, and my Father in heaven gave me a mother called a church. And that church has provided for me and my family since the day I gave my life to Jesus. And I thank those of you that continue to give of your tithe and your offerings, and those of you that are here supporting what we're doing here this morning so that we can bring this message anywhere and everywhere. People from all over the world are watching this. This is amazing to me. I've seen different things that have come in, and people that wanting to be friends that have watched this, and comments that come to me. And so I do want to help you to see some things this morning. And the most important thing it sees, you're created in the image of God, and God is the greatest giver. And until we live in that image, then we're always going to be takers, 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 and fakers, 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 fakers. But when you give of your tithe, you give of your offering, there's a blessing that comes upon your life. And it just shows the heart of God here in Deuteronomy and chapter 24. I think I'm starting with verse 18. It says, "But you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you from there. Therefore I command you to do this thing. When you reap the harvest in your field, and you forget a sheaf in that field, you shall not go back to get it. It shall be for the stranger, for the fatherless, and the widow. And the Lord your God, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When you beat the olive trees, you shall not go over the boughs again. And it shall be for the stranger, and the fatherless, and the widow. When you gather grapes from your vineyard, you shall not glean in it afterwards. It shall be for the stranger, and for the fatherless, and for the widow. And you shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt. Therefore I command you to do this thing, that you be blessed." In whatever way God blesses you, we need to remember that. For the fatherless, for the widow, and for the stranger. That's what a church does. And so I encourage you, you have a number of ways that you can do that. If you go to our website, The Door Christian Fellowship at South Bay, or you can get involved, doorsb.com or sbay4j.com. You go up there to the website. And when you get to the website, if you click on Get Involved, you'll come up with a place called New Believers. And you'll see a New Believers card will come down and you can give, there'll be a tithe and offering, there'll be an online giving button that'll be there. And that online giving button, you can press on that, and then you'll be able to give as the Lord has blessed your life. And we trust that that'll be great. I'm going to sing that song, "I'll Enter His Gates with Thanksgiving in My Heart." I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Thank you again for your tithe and for your offerings. See, they were required to do that God's blessing could be upon their life. The tithe is what they would normally bring in. The offering is what they left behind. They didn't go back to get anything. They left it all there. And God said, I want to leave that for the fatherless, for the motherless, the widow, and for the stranger. I want to talk to you about the impossible woman today, because you know your mother, you know you are a mother when your idea of a good day is making it through without your child leaking any bodily fluids on you. And you know you're a mother when you're desperate for adult conversation and you're talking to a telemarketer and you're pouring your heart out to the telemarketer because you're desperate for a conversation with an adult and then he hangs up on you. And you know you're a mother when spit is your number one go-to cleaning agent. And you count the sprinkles that are on a cupcake to make sure they're all equal so that each kid has the same amount. You know you're a mother when you can only get the time to shave one leg at a time. And you know you're a mother when you hide in the bathroom to be alone. One man said, "The bravest battle that was ever fought, shall I tell you where or when? On the maps of the world, you will not find it. It was fought by mothers trying to make their boys become men." So I want to talk to you this morning. This is an impossible job that you are tasked with. And while women are trying to be this ideal woman, they want to have the right nails, they want to have the right eyelashes, they want to have the right eyebrows, they want to have the right toenails. While they're trying to be this ideal woman to attract this ideal man, who's trying to be the ideal man to attract this ideal woman, somewhere in the process of that, motherhood has gotten lost in both men and women, in the confusion of all that's gone on in this world. So I want to talk to you about the impossible woman, because the world is making it impossible for a woman to be the woman that God called her to be. And women are helping in that. It's a sad thing. And men are helping in that to their own detriment. The only woman you can become is the one that God created you to be. And if you become the woman God created you to be, you'll be perfect. You'll be the impossible woman. And you'll help that man in ways that you are really and not really aware of. And it is impossible for you to become that person without the God who created you helping you become that one. And there are several objectives that I have this morning in this message. The first objective that I have is to help women and men to see the high value and the high view that God places not only on womanhood, but also on manhood. The second thing is that you would honor yourself as a woman, as a mother, by placing that same value that Jesus Christ places upon your life. Thirdly, I want you to make the connection between Jesus and the church and motherhood. And lastly, I want you to honor your mother and also the church that God has called you into and brought birth through your life for that and called you to be a part of. I want to talk to you about the confusion of motherhood. I want to talk to you about the comfort of motherhood. And I want to talk to you finally about the cooperation of motherhood. Let's read the book of Proverbs and chapter 31. We're going to skip around in there a little bit, but I do, I do encourage you to read that several times. There's so much in there. As I said, when I watched Pastor Greg Farrell preaching today, one of the verses in here, it just came out and exploded in my mind. I said, I need to preach on that. Proverbs chapter 31 starts with verse 1, and it says, "The words of King Lemuel, the utterance which his mother taught him." If you skip down to verse 10, it says, "Who can find a virtuous wife? For her rubies, for her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her, so he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and willingly works with her hands. She, like a merchant ship, she brings her food from afar. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and a portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and she buys it from her profits. She plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arms. She perceives that her merchandise is good and her lamp does not go out by night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hand holds the spindle. She extends her hand to the poor. She reaches her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow of her household, for all the household is clothed in scarlet. She makes tapestry for herself. Her clothes is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates, and when he sits among the elders of the land, she makes linen garments and sells them. She supplies sashes for her merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue, listen to these words, this is what struck me, and on her tongue, on a mother's tongue, is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household. She does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children will rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful, beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Father, we come by the precious blood of your Son, Jesus. We come with no confidence in our own flesh. We come, O God, with our confidence in the mothers that you birthed us to, O God. We thank you for them wherever they are, our grandmothers, O God. We thank you for the mother church that you birthed our lives in, that you've given us a life. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you're helping us to value women and mothers as for who they are. Move upon our lives. Help us to be the men that you want us to be, O God, and help us to help the women that are trying to help us be that, Lord. I'm asking you that in the name of Jesus. Amen. I want you to think, first of all, with me about the confusion of motherhood. There's a confusion in motherhood because of convenience. And that's an inconvenient truth that I want to talk to you about motherhood here for a moment. There is no easy way to be a woman and a mother or a mother unless it's God's way. And even then, it's going to take all of God and all of you. Because what woman wants to be all of those things without Jesus Christ helping her to be? But that's what she's created to be and the importance of that. And the inconvenient truth is that women try to do it the world's way. They try to be a mother before there ever been a wife. And that doesn't work. And the author of this is a man named Lemuel. I don't know if that's how you say his name. But most people think it was Solomon that was writing this. And it was writing the words that his mother Bathsheba had given to him. He wrote under different names. And obviously, Solomon did not take his mother's advice. Take your mother's advice. Solomon didn't take his mother's advice. Multiple heathen women he entrusted himself with. Over 1,000. I don't know who counted them all, but they said he had 1,000 women, 700 wives, and that not listening to his mother was ultimately a large part why the richest and the wisest man that had probably more women than any man will ever have didn't make it to heaven. That being the case, then you can begin to exclude money, sex, women, and in terms of if you want to really enjoy your life here on this earth and hopefully have a better one from here. 1 Kings and chapter 11, verse 1 says, "But Solomon loved many foreign strange women." That was my life. Solomon loved many foreign strange women, as well as the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Edomites, the Sidonians, the Hittites, from the nations of whom the Lord said to the children of Israel, "You shall not intermarry with them, nor with you. Surely they will turn away your hearts after the gods, after their gods." Solomon clung to these in love. Really? And he had 700 wives, princesses, all of them, 300 concubines, And his wives turned away his heart. You know, as I was thinking about that, that's exactly what Bathsheba had done to David. I know you all want to blame David, but, you know, and I do blame David because he wasn't the man he should have been, but somehow I feel that Bathsheba probably had a little bit to do with this. I don't think she was totally innocent in this, and she may have been, but that's okay. But now you hear her giving her son, listen, this is what you got to look for in a woman. She's going to help you become a man. The absolute worst thing that a mother can do is not see herself for who God created her to be. Because when that happens, men are totally lost. Women are enslaved by their own foolishness, and then women always pay a bigger price for stupid. Women always pay a bigger price for foolishness. Because they're going to be the ones that have to take that child and carry that child for 9 months, bring that child, and try to do that on their own. They pay a bigger price. The Bible is very, very clear. The wisest man, the richest man, was too stupid to follow his own mother's advice. You know, when you read the Bible, it's an incredible book. The first seven times that the word good is in the Bible, it's about creation. It's about God making his creation. It's about him creating everything. He created the light and it was good. And he created the darkness and it was good. He created the birds and it was good, 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 good. Everything was good. And then when he came to man, he said, you know, something's not good here. So seven times it's good, then it's not good. Then he creates a woman and he said, you know what? It's very good now. It's very good. This is God's intention. This is God's design, that he creates a woman, and seven times he says it's good, but after he creates the woman, he says this is very good. This is the last creative act of God. Everything else God created, he created out of dirt, but he created a woman, the pinnacle of God's creation, the crown of God's creation. He created her from the rib of a man, and he took her out of something that was essential in that man. That's why a man needs a woman more than a woman needs a man. And she took something essential out of that man and made that woman, took a living thing, and made another living thing. She's the only created living thing that was made from another living thing. And he gives her the ability to create other living things. Oh, that's radical, my sisters. You got to get a hold of that. That is radical, what he's done. You know, you start off as a girl, then you go to a woman, then you become a wife, then you become a mother, and then you become a grandmother. And oh, I tell you, in God's order, it's a wonderful thing. And so many people are blessed in time. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18, it says, the Lord God said, it is not good for a man to be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. A helper, well, what is she going to help him do? She's going to help him become the man that she needs him to be. I'm here to tell you that motherhood makes manhood, motherhood makes womanhood, and it all happens that way. In verse 23 of the same chapter, it says, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman. Because she was taken out of the man. The only created living thing that is given the ability to create other living things. He called her woman. Actually, God called her woman. If you read the verse before that. And Adam said, wow, man, this is all right. No, some people say, whoa, man. We'll call her whoa, man. No, I think he called, wow, man. He would actually change her name, which is pretty interesting. And so when you look at this, the world is hurting because men are not being men, because women are not being women. And I don't know which came first, the chicken or the egg, but I'm betting that a chicken came first because Adam was the one that God placed the responsibility on. When he wouldn't become that man, God brought that woman out of him. The confusion that's in the heart of a young girl today. She doesn't see the obvious that the world is trying to take all these things that she's not, to try and make her something that she's not. And it's impossible for her to become who God created her to be without God. This disastrous plan of hell that she's cooperating with. But I pray that you'll cooperate with God and let him become the one that'll help you become who you are becoming in him. It's impossible to be a woman, what the world puts before you. Come on, you can't never be that woman. It's foolish to watch. It's impossible to be the woman without Jesus Christ. Women are left with two impossibilities that they cannot become, and only one can they become, and that's the one. And convenience is the cause of all that. Skipping the steps of life. Genesis chapter 3, we see Adam taking full responsibility here. I got a whole message out of this one. Genesis 3:20, Adam called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living. You listen to that, girls. This is after they fell in the garden. This is after they've been put out of the garden. This is after they'd sinned. And Adam looks at this and he takes full responsibility, knowing that God is somehow going to redeem all of this. And he knows that that woman right there, that woman is the creator of all living things because God's given her that ability. And he changes her name to Eve. The attributes of a woman and a mother. You're hardwired to respond to those things. There is no shortcut. There is no substitute. You'll never be happy and fulfilled any other way. You know, when you read this proverb, it's an alphabetic proverb. It's an acrostic proverb. It's an acronym proverb. What that means is that each verse begins with a single letter of the alphabet, of the Hebrew alphabet. They really thought about this when they put it all together. This is a virtuous woman. They're rare. They're strong. They're a force of their own. As a woman of valor because she knows what her value is. She's a woman of excellence in every form of living. It's God who made you, and only God can make you that. It's impossible any other way. He starts out by speaking about a wife. But let me tell you something. Motherhood has a beginning, and it's not pregnancy. It's not pregnancy. It's a wife. It's a girl, then a woman, then a wife. And the sacrifices that you make as a wife, working with that man, the sacrifices that you make with a wife before children ever come along prepares you for having children. And the confusion comes because of convenience. David knew what it was to be fatherless. David knew what it was to be motherless. He had both a father and a mother, just as I had. But they had abandoned him. Psalms 27, verse 9. Says, do not hide your face from me, O God. Do not turn your servant away in anger, for you have been my help. Do not leave me, nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. In Psalm 68 and verse 6, he says, verse 5, a father of the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in the holy habitation. God sets the solitary in families. He brings those who are bound into prosperity, but the rebellious will dwell in a dry land. David understood what it was like to be fatherless, what he likes to be motherless. But you've got to see how he saw God and how God helped him become the man he could become. And he didn't do it all right. Nobody does. And trying to be anybody else besides who God created you to be is devastating to everyone, especially if you're a mother. It's so important for you to see this morning. We're not only looking at a fatherless generation. We understand that. We are also looking at a motherless generation because mothers have not seen the value that God places upon that. And the confusing message that's there by convenience. There's nothing convenient about being a mother. Nothing convenient. Serving and sacrificing, they only become fulfilling when you see the honor and the legacy that happens for that, for the children and for those mothers. You know, I texted my two daughters and my daughter-in-law, and I texted my wife this morning, and just helping, trying again to see the value that they are. And I look at the legacy, because I texted my daughters. I said, you know what, one of the greatest joys in my life has been watching you go from a little girl to a young woman, to a young wife, to a young mother. I said, I probably won't be around to see you go become a grandmother. But I'm so thankful for the example that you had in your mother. I want you to look secondly with me at the comfort and the confidence of true compassion, as opposed to the guilt-ridden confusion. And most mothers, that guilt-ridden confusion just doesn't do it for you. But you're free in Jesus. And that comfort that you bring, and the confidence of that true compassion. Because you know your mother when you're up each night until 11 o'clock. 11 each night. And you're vacuuming, dusting, wiping, washing, drying, unloading, loading, shopping, cooking, driving, flushing toilets, ironing, sweeping, picking up clothes, changing sheets, changing diapers, bathing kids, helping them with their homework, paying bills, budgeting, clipping coupons, folding clothes, and playing baseball, and dragging kids out of bed, trying to put them in bed, brushing their teeth, chasing them, buckling them. Plus, doing all the other things, cuddling dolls, rollerblading with them, basketball, football, playing catch with them, blowing bubbles, sprinklers, running under the water with them, slides, nature walks, coloring, crafts, jump rope, plus raking and trimming and planting and edging, mowing and gardening, painting and walking the dog. You get up at 5:30 in the morning and you still have no time to eat or sleep or drink, or even go to the bathroom. And after doing all of that, you still manage to gain 10 pounds. I'm pretty sure that a man didn't put that list together, because we don't see all that, but that's as powerful as I can say it to you. The characteristics of the way God intended a woman to be describes her importance to us. He describes what a woman will be with God helping her, with Jesus helping her. He describes what a man should be and what a man should be looking for in a wife. Don't look for a princess. If you get a princess, you're going to get one. Look for a woman that knows how to serve. Look for a woman and how she deals with other people. Why wouldn't a woman want to be all that she could be? Because of what the world tells them. And the confusion of convenience. And when the comfort that God brings. Why would a man ever think that he could settle for less? Sin has a strange quality to it. It says, I know better than God what's best for me. And we have absolutely no proof of that. In the book of Deuteronomy, you see God's care and concern again in verse 17. He said, for the Lord your God is a God of gods. He's the Lord of lords. He's a great God, a God as a mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality, and he doesn't take a bribe. He administers justice for the fatherless and the widow, and he loves the stranger, giving him food and clothing. Therefore, love the stranger, for you are strangers in the land of Egypt. Deuteronomy again, chapter 14, says at the end of every third year, you'll bring out the tithe of your produce of that year. You'll store it up within your gates. And the Levite who has no portion nor inheritance with you, and the stranger and the fatherless and the widow that were within your gates may come and eat and be satisfied, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work that you set your hands to do. God wants to bless our lives. And even when we're fatherless, and even then when we're a widow, I count widows in the same class as single moms. They have no man. And God works with them. God values them. And the Levite, you know what the Levite is? You take care of the Levite. The Levite was the one that ministered the word of God to everybody. And so I'm a Levite. You best take care of me. And the truth be known is, but so are you, because you're all ministers of the gospel. It's not a new phenomenon today that children are fatherless and motherless, but it is one that's getting way out of control, but not out of God's control. Go to him and talk to him, a woman of God that you can become, to help you become a man of God. This is God's plan from the garden. This has been what's been disrupting it all along. You got fatherless men and motherless men. You got fatherless women and motherless women trying to bring up children. It's not going to work without Jesus. Look at this woman called mother. She's a wife and the mother of great values. She lives for her home. She lives for her family. The scripture that we read, verse 10, says, "Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her. She will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks out wool and flax. She willingly works with her hands. She is like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household, a portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and she buys it from her profits. She plants a vineyard." Here's a woman that is constantly industrious, a woman that is self-disciplined and orderly. Here's a woman that is sharp with money. She's wise with money. She has good and refined tastes. She's been given to hospitality. She's always comfortable in her own home. She's always trying to reach out to the lost. She's a strong force because she's a spiritual force first of all. Charm is deceitful. Beauty is vain. Flesh has no profit, it has no gain, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised, and her children will rise up and call her blessed. This man wrote a similar translation of that. It goes like this: "Who can find a virtuous woman for her value of her life is beyond monetary calculations. Her husband absolutely trusts in her. He has no need to find satisfaction in any other woman. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She keeps his clothing up to date and tidy and clean. She willingly and lovingly works around the house. She provides meals at all times, a wise selection of nutritious and delicious foods. She gets up very early in the morning and she makes sure that her children will eat properly. The strength of her character is shown in her attitude towards her house. Household tasks. She knows a bargain when she sees one, and she's always concerned about the future stability and supplied. She takes pride in her job well done, even if she must work late hours to accomplish it. She is wise in her speech. She especially knows how to say kind words. Her children are happy to talk to her friends about her. They say, 'This is my mom.' And her husband praises her to others, and other women may have done great deeds, but this type of wife, this type of mother, she ranks the highest. Popularity is deceitful. Glamour is shallow. But a woman who has a personal contact with a holy God shall not only be praised, but totally fulfilled in her womanhood and her motherhood." It helps manhood. Let me tell you, there ain't no way in God's good earth that any woman's want to become that impossible woman with Jesus. No way. The impossible woman, the only way it's possible is with Jesus Christ. and the comfort that she brings to you as a man, to you as a woman, and to you as a mother, and the comfort that he brings from you to others. Life is very uncomfortable today, and we have to understand why. It's simple. Life without God and life without mothers that understand their value and just let Jesus make them become the impossible woman. Too many mothers try to be mothers before they learn the sacrifice of being a wife. It's a sacrifice to be a wife. That sacrifice prepares you for that sacrifice of being a mother. And too many fathers do the same thing. You can't skip the steps. And mothers and workers, there's no comfort there. You know, even God himself likens himself to a mother. And that's why I'm talking about the mother church. Listen to the way Isaiah is describing God. A devoted mother that is able to bring comfort to her family. Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 18 says, "Who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall the earth be made to give birth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. Shall I bring to the time of birth and not cause delivery, say the Lord? Shall I cause delivery and shut up the womb, says your God? Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad with her. All you who love her, rejoice for the joy with her. All you who mourn for her, that you may be fed, be feed and be satisfied with the consolation of her bosom, that you may drink deeply and be delighted and the abundance of her glory. For thus says the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the heathen shall be like a flowing stream. Then you shall feed on her sides, you'll be carried and you'll be dandled on her knees as one whose mother comforts. So I shall comfort you. And you shall be comforted in Jerusalem." That's not only a very powerful prophecy about the birth of Israel in 1948, but that's also the picture of God's comfort that he brings to a woman. And that comfort that is there, that's a picture of the comfort of a mother. The love of a devoted, self-sacrificing mother has the comfort there in time of need to meet life's deepest need. God has gifted her with that art of comfort. God has helped that. And it's more than a man who desperately needs that comfort at times. And that's what the church, that's the whole birthing of the church, is to try and place a place where people can come and get some sanity in life. The Holy Spirit is actually described as a comforter. He said he will not leave you as orphans, as fatherless or motherless. You know, men want to know every detail when a child is born. Well, how much did it weigh? How many hours did you have labor? Was it difficult? We thank God that men don't give. If man gave birth, you should have seen me, man. I was there and I was tough. I pushed. It was 1 hour. It was 2 hours. It was an incredible strenuous thing when the child was born. But a mother just wants to show you the baby. She just wants to show you the baby. The comfort. You know, a woman doesn't probe the wound. She brings forth the power to heal, called a silent comfort. It's called the mother's inarticulation. Not adding to the wound, but helping to close it in a silent comfort. So we have the confusion that causes by convenience of motherhood. But then we have the comfort and compassion of motherhood. So let me finish with one final thought about cooperating with God for that to happen. Cooperating with God for that special gift of life that he has given to you. And as a man, ask God to help you to see women the way he sees them. You know, there's 12 things my mother taught me, this man wrote. My mother taught me, the first thing she taught me was about anticipation. She said, just wait till your father gets home. The second thing she taught me was about receiving. She says, you're going to get it when we get home. The third thing that she taught me was about challenge. When she looked at me and she said, "What are you thinking?" And then when I was afraid to ask her, and she goes, "Don't just answer me when I talk to you." There's always a challenge. And then she would say to me, "Don't talk back to me." I mean, she talked to me about challenge, man. My mother taught me about logic. She said, if you fall out of that swing and you break your neck, then you're not going to go to the store with me today. My mother taught me about medical science. She says, if you don't stop crossing your eyes, then they're going to freeze that way. My mother taught me about how to think ahead. She said, if you don't pass that spelling test, you're not going to get a good job. My mother taught me about humor. She says, when the lawnmower cuts off your toes, then don't come running to me. My mother taught me about how to become an adult. She said, if you don't eat your vegetables, you'll never grow up. My mother taught me about genetics. She said, you're just like your father. My mother taught me about wisdom of the age. She goes, when you get to be my age, you'll understand. And finally, my mother taught me about justice. She said, one day you'll have kids. And I hope they turn out just like you. You'll see what it's like. You know, it's impossible for children to grow up whole in a fractured family. Fatherless and motherless, we all need Jesus. One of the biggest frustrations that I see as a pastor in Los Angeles is that people here are in such tremendous need, incredible need, not recognizing how much Jesus can fill that need, or thinking that they can still do it without him and their lives. I mean, the people that I've met in the time I've been in Los Angeles, they are all worst case scenarios. It's like just when you hear one worst case scenario and you thought that's the worst you ever heard, you got another one. Fatherless, motherless, Jesusless, that's the problem. They have nothing. The numbers are astounding. Hurting men that never become men because a woman doesn't understand how important her life is as a mother. My prayer is that you got that this day, girls. That you're the last creative act of God. The only living thing created from another living thing that has the ability to create other living things. Help meet to help that man become the man that you need him to become. You know, I thought about this when I first wrote this down, that I was the product of a single mom. And I've produced some single moms. I've produced some fatherless children. But I've watched what Jesus Christ can do with single moms. I've watched what he's done with this fatherless and motherless child and the compassion and the concern that he has for me when I look at every woman. I don't see them as sexual objects. I see them as impossible women that God wants to make possible for them. I see their children. And I look at mothers in the Bible and the value that Jesus Christ placed on mothers. One of the dying words, one of his last words was, look, take care of my mother. Don't make it your dying word. Make it your first word. Take care of your mother. Honor her. Let it be your first thought. She's your first teacher. She's your earliest and most influential lesson of life is there. And what is the message? The message is cooperate. Forget about the confusion. Forget about the convenience. Look at the comfort that you can have and the comfort that you can bring and cooperate. Look at other mothers. Look at Jochebed. Who? Jochebed. Jochebed was Moses' mom. She was Moses' mom. And she gave him to God. And God gave her to him back again. This Bible is an incredible word. Look at Hannah. She couldn't have a child, and that was Samuel's mother. Look at Lois and Eunice. That was a grandmother and a mother, and Timothy was brought from them and the faith that was in them. Look at Mary. That was Jesus' mother. These aren't some saints in a stained glass window. These are women just like you. These are women that just like you, that and our mothers that have worked. They cooperated with God. Let me tell you something. Religion twists women. Religion twists men. Let God untwist you. Let the truth move in your life. Real truth. Susanna Wesley had 19 kids, 19 children, but she would lock herself away for 1 hour every day and pray for every one of them. Probably her only means of sanity with 19 kids. The rewards of being a real man, a real woman, a real husband, a real father, a real mother. The impossible woman is only possible through Jesus, and she also helps the impossible man. Just a casual read of the Bible, you can see how much Jesus cares about women. And you can see, I really want to find out how many women are actually in the Bible that he healed. We can start with Peter's mother-in-law. She was healed of a fever. You can also talk about the widow's son that was raised from the dead. You watch Jesus Christ move in these people's lives. You can talk about Jairus, and it was his 12-year-old daughter that was raised from the dead. It's God moving in women's life. You can talk about the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. You can talk about the woman at the well, and I'm talking about her tonight. I'm going to give her an opportunity to talk this evening. She's a very powerful spoken word that this woman brings about that woman at the well. You can talk about Mary Magdalene. You can talk about Mary and Martha. You can talk about Anna the prophetess. Why wouldn't a woman cooperate with Jesus? Because the future of mankind, the future of mankind, the future of manhood, the future of womanhood and motherhood depends upon the impossible becoming possible. You know, you're not always going to have your mother with you. I miss mine. I didn't think much of her when she was alive. I didn't help her very much. In fact, I caused her a lot more harm than help. I only got to see my mother 20 times. In 20 years. Really only 10 times, because I got to spend the last 10 days of her life with her. And I served her and I helped her get to heaven. My mom's in heaven, and I can hear her shouting amen when I'm preaching here tonight. Jesus brought me 13,000 miles to pray with my mother. She had been a Christian, but she would not have gone to heaven. That's a whole nother sermon. But I'm just going to finish with this one. I confronted her. I comforted her. I received her comfort to my dying mother with the truth. And she's happy today. You know, I had the same opportunity to do that with my father, even though I had no relationship with him. Why? Because I've got a father in heaven, and I've got a church as my mother that has raised me up as a man. I may not be the best, I may not be the most slick, but I tell you, I've watched God do miracles, so I watched him do the impossible. I want to finish with one final thought about this woman, Proverbs 31:25, and I'll leave you. Strength and honor are her clothing. She doesn't need Nemus Marcus. She doesn't need Nordstrom. She shall rejoice in the time to come. She sees the future. She sees her daughters and her daughter's daughters, her children, her children's children. She opens her mouth with wisdom. Listen to these words. And on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over her household. She does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you exceed them all. Charm is deceitful, beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Charm is deceitful, beauty is vain, flesh is unfaithful, it is of no gain. The impossible woman is possible And I thank you for all you mothers that are cooperating with God and the comfort that you bring to your children. I pray that there'll be no more confusion looking for convenience. I want you to bow your heads with me. I'd like every head bowed, every eye closed. You can receive Jesus right there where you are, whatever state you're in, whatever country you're in, whatever state of mind you're in. Whether you're a mother that's hurting and lonely, whether she's had the betrayal from her children, whether you're a single mom and you've been betrayed by men, whether you're a mom that's been fatherless and motherless, whether you're a grandmother, life without Jesus is impossible. It's impossible for a man. It's impossible for a woman. He shed his blood for you and I on the cross at Calvary. They buried him and he rose again on the third day. And by the power of his Holy Spirit, he's here. That's why he created women, to be helpmeet. Oh, listen to me, my brother. You better recognize that helpmeet, because if you don't, you won't have her long. She helps you become the man you need to be for her, and you help her become the woman you need her to be for you. You're not born again. You've never given your life to Jesus. Chances are you've given your life to lots of other things, but they have not given you life. They've simply taken your life through the convenience and the confusion that somehow we can do this some other way beside God's way. There's no confusion when you understand there's nothing convenient on the face of this earth today. 7-Eleven's a convenience store. You can go there and buy a bottle of water for $1.50. You can go to Costco and buy it for like 20 cents. Convenience is always going to cost you more, and you wind up with less. He shed his blood for you and I on the cross at Calvary. That wasn't convenient. And he did that so he could pay for all of our sins. If you acknowledge that this morning, he'll come into your life and begin to change your life from the inside out. He'll make the impossible possible. Would you pray with me right now? Get down on your knees as a sign of humility. Humble yourself before the mighty hand of God, because he cares for you. Close your eyes, open your heart, and pray with me. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you as I am, a sinner with no hope except the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus, I believe that you died for me on the cross, that they buried you, and that you rose again on the third day. I want you to come into my heart. I want you to forgive me of my sin. I want you to help me to forgive others who have sinned against me. I want you to help me to forgive myself for the sins I've caused myself. I want you to help me to forgive myself for the sin that I've caused others. Father, that forgiveness would change me forever. And right now, I receive your love, your acceptance, and your forgiveness. And I'm born again. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. My prayer is that you'll have a happy Mother's Day today. Because a happy Mother's Day, happy days for everybody. If you prayed that prayer, you can go to our website and you can see Get Involved. If you click on that tab, Get Involved, a drop-down menu will come. You'll see a thing called New Believers. If you click on that New Believers, you can just fill in that information right there down the bottom of that form, which you can't see. You can submit that. That'll come to us, and we'll do everything we can to try and help you see how valuable you are to the church and how valuable the church really is to you. If anybody's got children that have all gone astray, the church does. The church does. But it continues to reach out. It continues to give. Because that's not what mothers do. That's who mothers are. That is the giving nature of a mother. We're going to be back here this evening at 6:30. And I'm going to talk about the woman with three strikes. She actually had six strikes. She had five husbands. And she was with number six, who wouldn't even get her some water. So I'm pretty sure she probably had some children, too, with five men. So I want to encourage you to come on back. The Word of God is powerful. There's so much truth. That truth is what ultimately sets you free. Let me just pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the mothers. The grandmothers, oh God, I thank you for the women in our lives. As men, help us to value them as you value them. Help us to value them, oh God. Help us to bring that value to them. The value that you place upon a godly girl. The value that you place upon a godly woman. The value that you place upon a godly wife. The value that you place upon a godly mother. The value that you place upon a godly grandmother. The value that you place upon a godly friend. Father, they'd not look, in the confusion of convenience. God, they'd see the comfort that you provide to them and that they can provide to others. Oh God, help us to see the wonder in that cooperating with you in this impossible endeavor as men and women. Oh Father, by the name of Jesus, I pray that you'll bring comfort to every woman, every mother, every grandmother that hears this message. Oh God, help them to see themselves as you see themselves, oh Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song and count ourselves dismissed. Thank you for being with us on this Mother's Day. Love your mother. Put your arms around her right now and just pray with her. And love her. Lift Jesus higher. Lift Jesus higher. Lift him up for the world to see. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Lift Jesus higher, lift Jesus higher, lift him up for the world to see. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. The Lord bless you.